And I lay claim to that promise in my life, and I hope someday the Lord will bring me there. Praise God. You know, it is in our life. And I look back in my life at all the things that I used to be interested in. I used to be so much into entertainment, into music, books, movies. I had all kinds of fiction books and CDs and 10,000 songs on my iPod and 500, I had like over 500 DVDs, movie collection. You know, and that's what I was being entertained with. And at that time, that was my escape because I didn't know the Lord. So I needed something to try to remove the burden. And it never worked. So as I come to know the Lord through a gradual process, He took away my desire, and I prayed for it because I was fed up and I was upset because I didn't want to be entertained by that. I want to be entertained by the Word of God. And I was struggling with that. Why couldn't I just pick up the Word and read it every day and enjoy it? You know, I didn't have that discipline at that time. And I prayed and prayed about it, and gradually the Lord took the desire from me to like all those things, and I got rid of them all. And it was He went through in the Word and delivered me from all the spirits that come with those things. And I praise God for it because I'm a different man now for giving up all those things. And the Lord has enabled me to seek His Word daily. And it's a miracle, I have to say. Amen. It's a miracle for the things He's worked in my life. And, you know, that's we need to adhere to the yield. That's the most important foundational principle in our Christian walk, is yielding. We must first yield unto the Lord. We must first give everything we have unto the Lord. Once we do that, that's how we are emptied out, and that's how the Lord can come in and start taking control of things for us. Amen. You know, the Lord makes it so simple for us if we just give it all to Him. He wants to take care of everything. If you have a problem, go to Him and lay it all on the table. He wants you to rely upon Him. The second foundational principle would be prayer. And all prayer originates in heaven. And I looked up the definition that the 1828 Webster gives, and it says, for prayer, it says, in worship, a solemn address to the Supreme Being consisting of adoration or an expression of our sense of God's glorious perfections, confession of our sins, supplication for mercy and forgiveness, intercession for blessings on others, and thanksgiving, or an expression of gratitude to God for His mercies and benefits. Now that covers a lot. And the practice of supplication or petition or earnest request, if we, First Thessalonians 5:16-17, it says, rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. Prayer is so important too, because prayer is how we communicate with God. Prayer is how we develop a relationship with the Lord. If you think about your friends you've had in your life, the relationships you had in your life with a spouse, with a best friend, a brother, sister, or anyone, you've had to develop a relationship over time. You had to build trust. You had to talk and communicate. And the same thing is with Jesus Christ, our Savior. You have to talk to Him, and He will talk back. Praise God. And as we pray and learn to communicate, the Lord will, you'll build a trust with one another. The Lord learns to trust you, what He can trust you with, as you step out in faith and listen to Him, what He's trying to tell you. But prayer also, you know, it enables us to cry out to the Lord for all our needs. It enables us to glorify God, to tell God how much we love Him. It does so much. And more so when we're yielding unto the Lord and seeking His righteousness. James 5, 16 says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So that the more that we're seeking to apply these things in our life, the more closer we come to taking on that righteousness, the more powerful our prayers become.
Yes.
You see, we seek that anointing in the Spirit in every aspect of our lives, especially in prayer. Because when the Lord gives us the words to speak in heaven, that's the initial process that starts the flow of the Spirit. The Lord gives us the words from heaven, the Spirit comes down, we give Him back up. It's just a constant flow. So the more we do that, the more we establish that connection, the more that we're moving in the flow of God, the more He can work in our life, the more He can show us, the more He can open up to us in the Scripture. I mean, it's so important that we pray. Like it says in Thessalonians, pray without ceasing. You cannot pray too much. Amen. I thank God for that. That we have a God that we can talk to, that can be our intimate personal friend, that can be our teacher, that can be our Father, that can be our Lord, our King, and our God. He's everything to us. And I just thank God for that, that we can have a personal relationship with Him. We need to rely upon any man. We just rely upon the Lord, and He's always there for us.
Yes.
So if we move on and go to the third foundational principle, and that would be fasting. And that's not something that you hear too many people teaching on nowadays. And it's something that I've been learning to apply in my life, and I've been seeing results, and I've been working with brothers here on it as we've come together. And there's so many benefits to fasting that I can't cover them all here today. But I'll do my best with what the Lord would like for me to show today. But in essence, fasting becomes prayer. There are moments in our life where it seems like we pray and pray and pray, but we're not seeing results. And yes, we have to learn patience, but what we could do more than pray is to fast and pray. And in Psalm 35:13, he writes, but as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. I humbled my soul with fasting, and my prayer returned into my bosom. Praise God. It was through fasting that enabled his prayers to come more to life, to return to his bosom, that he saw the results. And it is a basic foundational principle. If we turn to Matthew chapter 9, we'll see that Jesus placed a fast on us all. And that was chapter 9, verse 15. And he writes, and Jesus said unto them, can the children of the bridegroom mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? But the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken from them, and then they shall fast. So even from that time, the Lord is calling us to fast. It's part of the foundational walk with God. And it's part of His design that He's given us in our walk to give us so much, to open the door to so much in our life. Our Lord Jesus Christ set the example. Before He started His ministry, He went out in the desert on a 40-day fast. And that's how He began His ministry. That's how He began serving the Lord in such a manner. Before He started His ministry, He went out and fasted. And for 40 days, which seems like an incredible time.
Yes.
Which it is. And when He was out there, was fasting for 40 days, and towards the end of that fast is when He entered into a point of starvation. And that's when the devil came and tried to tempt Him. And it's all that preparation that He did that gave him the power to resist the devil.